denying staff of their own particular areas of activity, their own particular responsibilities in regard to sickness and ill health and well-being issues as well. We have a staff support scheme which allows members of staff to contact independently if they're struggling in their particular position. And we do regularly receive updates both to Policy Performance Committee but certainly to senior leadership team about the causes of ill health and the growth in particular areas of what we can do about those in specific by addressing those. And I guess the final thing to do is that, you know, as all of those hopefully are ways of helping and supporting individuals, but it is beholden upon us as an organisation, as managers and staff, to ensure the staff are in a position to return to work. So we have a series of meetings on a 6-weekly basis where each strategic director sits with the relevant chief officer to go through every single level of absence to ensure that we are following the due process that we have, and where that's not happening is to then do something about it.
Very helpful, thank you.
Thank you both,
to the strategic leadership team next month
to conduct an exercise later in the year with a view of making sure that the picture and register continue to reflect on this critical list. So obviously updates on both that process and the access points will be brought back to this panel.
Okay, any questions?
On page 81, there's a section about the pace of change, and in the section on what additional actions are being taken to mitigate the risk, there's a reference to using the remodelling fund for additional capacity if required. Perhaps we just have an idea of what's being used in the remodelling fund and what that is.
I'm afraid I don't have a great deal of information personally on that specific point.
Thank you, Chair. Tom and I may do a double up on it. In terms of when we went through the future council process last year, we identified quite clearly that in terms of our delivery mechanism, we did need to provide a level of financial support to ensure that at certain times in our development, additional input required from both organisations but also individuals to help us deliver it. Clearly, as we go forward in terms of our 2020 strategy, I think that's been even more highlighted and more important. One example in terms of what you've seen is that you've seen some recent press coverage about some individuals who've been working with us on a short-term, high-paced, focused piece of work. So I don't think we'll do so. We will be looking to supplement some of our processes in terms of by providing external support. We are in the process of developing a programme management office to ensure that we deliver what we set out to achieve. Because I think one of the issues that was highlighted in the annual governance statement is about sustainability of the organisation. And clearly, I think that's what we expect to see in terms of next, when we discuss next week about the money statement for my external auditors. It's all very well achieving that in year, but it's also about giving confidence that we're in place for future years. And the transformation fund provides that opportunity that it would be used for one-off funding. And as part of that, it would be to kickstart new projects to ensure that things are embedded. Does provide the level of, I guess, foundation for the changes that we want to take place.
Yeah.
Analysis developed and then more detailed risk register as the and indeed the impact out in the community, if we'd like to get to grips with this. You can see that there are some very clear projects that have been delivered, particularly within adult social services, to try and help and mitigate the costs. Again, these will have their own risk elements built into them. It wouldn't necessarily come here, but within 4 years out, the policy performance committee for families and welfare.
Changes and in terms of horizon scanning, it's something we need to keep in mind.
clearly there's the deprivation of liberty standards has been around for a few years now. It probably didn't appear on the risk management strategy because it was being well managed. But there was a landmark case earlier this year, and as a consequence of that, the growth, as Mike said, then has been manyfold, both in our authority and every other local authority, every other authority. And so that's why it's on here, and we'll continue to work, as Mike said, to ensure that we can try and manage as best we can within the resources that are available to do those in a timely manner.
Okay, any more questions?
Can we read the recommendations?
Yep.
The maximum insurance to cover risk is another of the regulations for every. Again, this is aimed at informing members of progress with major projects and major recruitment activities. There were just 2 points that I was going to highlight specifically. If I could draw your attention to paragraph 222, which is the liability insurance contract. Since I drafted this report for you, the insurers came back to me with a very much improved proposal. And both I and the council's insurance brokers think that it would be in the broker's best interest to accept that much improved proposal. So I am in the process of writing to insurers to accept those. What that will mean is that the competitive procurement exercise for the liability insurers would now be undertaken as we'd originally planned in the latter half of next year, which we feel gives us a much better chance of doing the very best job than that.
Is this the jury sort of realizing they're not going to lose a lot of business if they don't suddenly decide the discount?
Yes,
it's
the
jury. It might well be to do with the recent 176 million pound loss they've just made in China, with some retained ships being on fire. But they pulled out of the merger with Northern. That's off the press today.
Fantastic.
They were going to take over and walk more down the end, but they thought that was because they had faced 160 million pounds in China.
Attention, if I may, is paragraph 223. Some members may already be aware that my colleague, Simon Hutchinson, was awarded professional leader in the National Alarm Awards in June, but I thought I'd formally report that back to you. It's nice to be able to present members with some good news.
Consider its practice of not getting authorizations
experience of the SAM, and training exercise in Harry's tender. His advice was that authorisations could only be sought and granted by a magistrate if the training standards section believed that the sale would be conducted surreptitiously by the retailer, and there would be a need for covert surveillance, either by the accompanying adult or the use of a concealed camera on a juvenile. In other cases where sales are expected to be conducted openly, there will be no covert surveillance, either and therefore no need for the authorisation. Third recommendation that the council could take care to ensure that the 3 month period permitted for surveillance and authorisation is stated to run from the date the magistrate approves it, not from the date it is signed by the council officer. And this lesson has been learnt, and authorisation since the inspection comply with this requirement by correctly stating the expiry date within 3 months and the date of the magistrate's approval, not from the date of the council officer's authorisation. And finally, as David recommended, that some minor amendments or improvements be made to the policy and guidance document, which appears in Appendix 2, and these changes have been made, including a section on monitoring of social media during investigations. So the recommendations is that the consistent surveillance commission's recommendations be adopted and manner suggested in the report, and that the revised policy document and guidance be approved.
Yeah, I'm looking for some of the reading self-explanatory. I just wanted to make a comment on today's class and that text or permission. I was trying to comment the highly commend our officers of the issue, but I think you should not go and notice the comments he's made in there. So it's embarrassing comments you're mentioned in the report. I highly mentioned you for your knowledge. Often our officers come in with lots of criticism from the general public and from the ranking members. Here's an external eminent person providing the report, where you're highly praised in our offices for their delivery service. I think, I would like that to go on the record. But this committee endorses their comments and congratulates our officers for the standard they are setting.
Are there no more patient visits? We're on.